Today's program, we have first Mimi Willard. Mimi is the founder of the Coalition of Sensible Taxpayers, COST, COST. Clever. COST is a nonpartisan, nonprofit organization that advocates for the interests of Marin taxpayers. So that's all of us. A chartered financial analyst, Mimi's professional background includes 20 years as a nationally recognized financial analyst at prominent Wall Street firms. Mimi's also a member of the Coalition. I'm sure many of you know her. Leslie Lemgren Harlander is the president of the Board of Trustees of the Tamalpais Union High School District. She's served on the TAM board for 2 years. Leslie's also a civil engineer. She's worked on a wide variety of public works and environmental projects with experience managing multi-million dollar projects and programs and overseeing all aspects of the work on her projects, including financial and budget management, personnel, community outreach, and QAQC. So with that, we will begin with Amy. So I welcome to the podium, Mimi Willard. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. thank you, Scott, for the kind and generous introduction. Thank you to the Marin Coalition for inviting the Coalition. Welcome again. The Coalition of Sensible Taxpayers was launched in January of 2017 with the idea being that Marin's taxpayers need a seat at the table. Why? Our sense was that the long-term public interest was far down the priority scheme. And taking perhaps a back seat to special interests and business as usual. So the Coalition of Sensible Taxpayers is an advocate for sensible solutions. High up in our scheme of what's important to us is that Marin should continue to be a place that's affordable to its current residents. And that means that taxes and fees, in the perfect world, wouldn't be going up faster than the average person's income, which is currently growing in a low single-digit rate. In order to achieve that goal, our agencies and districts have to be fiscally responsible. Taxes should be fairly distributed, and we put a lot of emphasis on transparency. So, our leadership group is people who have committed a substantial amount of time to taking on projects, and they're people who have something to contribute by the way of expertise in finance or research, public service, the law, maybe some technical capability. Today at our meeting, we have two of the people who are in our leadership group, who are on the board, and I'd like them to stand up. Paul Primo. Jeff Kelly are with us today. And unfortunately, some of our other leaders were not able to make it today, but they're all of their biographies are on our website. We also have an advisory board. And I think two or three people from our advisory board are here today. Susan Kirsch, who was also a co-founder of the Coalition of Sensible Taxpayers. Hutch Turner, who was very instrumental in our early days. And I think Al Dugan was going to be here, but I hadn't seen him. And again, we have a broader group there. So our mission at COST is not your typical anti-taxpayer group. We have a broader concept of what we want to achieve and also what we want to contribute to our community. So you see here listed some many of the activities that we're in, research and education and advocacy, new ideas. We facilitate and partner with local citizen groups who have maybe an issue they want to put on a ballot or that they want to get the word out about. And also we do contribute to our local boards and councils with advice and serving on taxpayer representative. We have articulated on our website our criteria for what we think is a sensible tax or fee, and we try to think about those principles when we come to the point of perhaps endorsing, opposing, or taking no position on a particular measure. I'll let you read these yourself, just for the sake of time, but I want to emphasize two of them. One of them is not duplicative. One thing that increasingly frustrates voter taxpayers is paying for the same thing over and over again. And another one, which I've underlined here, is the regular election. It's very important if we're going to have taxpayer support that a ballot measure be presented to the largest possible number of people, not a selected group via a special election. We're advocating for how our money gets spent. We want it spent wisely. It's important to set priorities and not do, as we saw in that first cartoon, just keep on the track of business as usual. In the wake of the Sonoma wildfires, I think many people in Marin think it's important to prioritize fire prevention. And maybe that means that you have to cut the pie in a slightly different way so that more of it goes to fire prevention. Now, our elected officials and staff throughout the county are working hard on fire-related issues, public education about defensible space, and also going after state grants. But what we really haven't seen is a reprioritizing of Marin taxpayer money within Marin. So, for example, the county recently gave direction to all of the departments within the county offices to cut 1% from spending across the board, including the county open space district, which should be responsible for vegetation management. And they're hard-pressed to even touch that relative to their number of acres. And then meanwhile, secondly, we've seen the San Geronimo Golf Course purchase going forward, which actually takes money from the general fund and from open space, money that we think would be better spent on fire prevention. So we've been involved in a lot of activities. We've been super busy over the last year. Here are some of the things that we have engaged in. You'll see here that we actually supported a tax, which was the Larkspur Essential Services Tax. I don't have time to go into all these now, but I'm happy to talk about them in Q&A if you're interested. And then, steady drip, 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 there's more coming your way in 2018 at the regional and state level. Again, I invite you to ask about these during Q&A if they interest you. And then we have local things that are going to be or are on the ballot in 2018, also listed here. And right now we have this big Dixie school tax ongoing, which is a special election parcel tax measure. And as I said before, at cost, we don't look favorably on these as special elections. Shifting gears now to big picture, we are fortunate here in Marin to have had the leadership from the citizens from Sustainable Pension Plans, led now by Jody Morales. And they sounded the alarm early and educated people in Marin about the specter of a growing unfunded pension liability and the prospect for that to make for some difficult choices going forward as to whether we will accept lower levels of services or higher taxes and fees. So they told us there was a pension tsunami coming, and the future's now. The pension tsunami is now breaking over our schools in particular, but also our cities and other jurisdictions and agencies. So we have here, so Sophie's choice. Are we going to cut services or raise taxes and fees? Pension problem, what pension problem? So it seems like there's a propensity when you have a ballot measure that it's presented to you as very important to support or even grow those basic services that matter to us the most, our schools, our fire and public safety, our cities, and so on. But inevitably you're told this is not, has nothing to do with the pensions. But the pensions are paid for out of the general fund, and then we get the add-on taxes. Well, these add-on taxes, they add up. Each one, we're told, is small. It's only $100 here, or $200 there, or $355. But this is a rearranged excerpt from my tax bill, and this is just the parcel taxes. So I'm paying the same as everybody else, and mine total over $3,400. That's before the recently approved increase in Kent Field School District of $355, and on top of the existing $1,143. TAM Union will be looking for an increase in their parcel tax later this year. All told, I expect that next year my parcel taxes will be about $4,000. And that doesn't include school and hospital bonds, which are according to the assessed value, but for the average assessed value in Marin now, that's going to be another $1,000. So your typical add-on taxes now, depends where you live, but it's probably somewhere between $4,000 and $5,000. Mythbuster. Not everyone in Marin can afford to pay more, and some people are having to move because of it or make other changes. This chart shows the distribution of income, household income, by quintile. So the fifth quintile all the way over to the right is what the myth is based on, and that's your high earners. And we do have a lot of high earners here in Marin, and it's one of the reasons we're one of the higher per capita counties in the country. The median income in that fifth quintile is $380,000. And so for them, the incremental parcel taxes really are a drop. Down in the first quintile, the median income is $19,000. Second quintile is $51,000, and the third quintile is $91,000. Now, I submit to you that second and third quintile, they have a fair number of homeowners in there. Homeowners are the ones who pay the parcel taxes. So if you've got $5,000 of parcel taxes and you have a $51,000 income, that's 10% of your pre-tax income. You've got a problem. And it's pinching on the third quintile, too. On the flip side of the page, our schools face increasing financial pressure. I think we collectively believe in the importance of public education, and we don't want to starve our schools. I won't go into this in detail because you'll hear more about that from Leslie. But one message that we at the Coalition of Sensible Taxpayers would try to get out there is the idea that we hope that for schools that the first round of whatever cost efficiencies or cuts have to be made would come out of things that don't hurt the students. Now, in reality, if you look at the financials of a school district, the biggest expense by far is people, and a large part of that people is teachers. So it's hard to save a whole lot of money without quickly getting to something that's painful. But this would be just one suggestion of a place where there's some inefficiency that maybe we ought to be talking about. And that is that we have multiple school districts throughout Marin. I've heard the count as 17 or 19. 19. I can only find 11 on Transparent California, which is kind of disturbing in and of itself. That's where you can find out about compensation. And so the 11 largest school districts in Marin, coupled with our County Office of Education, are responsible for 27,000 students, 49 schools, and the average compensation per superintendent is, in total, including benefits, is close to $300,000. And all of these districts, it's not just the superintendents, all these districts, they have their own staff, their own operating expenses that go with that. So there's a multiplier effect on this redundancy. Compare this to LA Unified, where there's 750,000 students and one superintendent who makes under $400,000. So, shifting gears now, I want to talk about the effect of benefits on the school's revenue pie. And basically what's happening is benefits are squeezing down all the other money that's available. So I chose Hamilton Pius Union High School District partly because Leslie will be speaking today, but also because they're pretty typical as far as what this pie looks like. In 2015, total benefits paid for by the district, putting aside whatever is paid out of pocket by the employees, they're taking up 20% of the revenue pie. That was in 2015, past tense. This year it will be a quarter of the pie, and by 2020 it will be 29% according to the district's projections. So what happens is that the other revenues, all the money that's left over for everything else besides benefits, is shrinking 9 percentage points from 80% to 71% over just 5 years. This is not sustainable. This is not strictly the school district's problem. There's a small part of this that's within the school district's control, which is they determine how much they will pay a new hire. They determine how many new hires they will have, and they do have negotiations that include things like healthcare. So it's not totally out of their control, but a big piece of this is out of their control, and that is that there are state mandates as to how much a school district, which is to say the taxpayers' piece of the money, has to be sent on to the state pension plans, CalSTRS for the teachers and CalPERS for the non-teaching staff within our school districts. And under legislation that was implemented in 2014, the districts are required to up their contribution to those pension plans from 8% in 2014, that's the green bar, up to 19% in 2021. They'll probably keep going from there, but that's as far as the law went. And think of that like a surcharge. In other words, whatever the salary is of your teachers, then you send 8% up to the state, growing to 19% for the STRS program. The PERS program was an 11% contribution rate in 2014, and it was mandated or projected to be a 27% contribution in 2025. So Leslie will talk about the fact that for many of our schools in Marin, the revenues don't go up when enrollment goes up. I'll let her dive into that. But I want to make one point that maybe she won't make, which is that new apartment complexes are problematic in terms of the fact that we're now using parcel taxes as our vehicle for propping up our school system, and apartment complexes, each apartment complex is one parcel. So this is a problem. So the current fix is parcel taxes. It's not a fair system. It's not a sustainable system. The burden falls almost entirely on single-family homeowners, and it slams the modest income condo owners. So everybody's paying the same, whether it's a mall or a one-room condo. A related problem, or a parallel issue, is that who votes for the parcel tax? And it turns out that many of the people who vote to approve or not approve a parcel tax are people who don't actually directly pay it. So seniors are exempt, which is appropriate, but they get to vote on the parcel taxes. And they are, in fact, often targeted by the campaigns to get the votes to pass those parcel taxes. The renters, they don't pay it directly, though it shows up in their rent. And if you're in a small complex, it will show up more materially in your rent. And they're now 37% of our population in Marin. So as Dick Spotswood said, I thought very cogently in an op-ed during the Kentfield Measure A contest, that what's happening is it's distilling down to those social divide, those who want it all versus those who can't afford it all. And that is resulting in our parcel tax elections, particularly for schools, becoming increasingly contentious and divisive. So at the Coalition of Sensible Taxpayers, we've tried to come up with a better idea, which so far, unfortunately, hasn't gotten a lot of traction with our districts. And we're proposing that they shift to parcel taxes based on building square footage. Now, California law requires that a parcel tax be uniform, but it actually doesn't define uniform. And so in three East Bay districts, large districts in the East Bay, in 2016, they enacted uniform parcel taxes by square footage of the buildings, and they passed by overwhelming margins. And what that does is it spreads the tax burden more equitably, and arguably, if you tweaked the numbers and you played with what happens at 35 cents per square foot or 25 cents per square foot, you might actually find you could lessen the burden on the people who can least afford to pay while upping the amount of money that you could get for the schools. So we encourage school districts and others to look at fairer alternatives. In our scoring system, integrity matters. So I want to talk a little bit about the games that consultants play when they advise our districts on how to get their tax measure passed. One of the favorite new things is an all-male special election, which was what was done in Kentfield and what is now on the ballot in mail-in ballot in Dixie. These are all male. What happens with an all-male ballot, it gives you, as the proponent of the tax, an opportunity to select who actually shows up to vote. Because in a general election, you get a very broad turnout. And if you want to reach the voters, you have to do huge mailings. And you can't probably afford to do as many mailings. Whereas with a special election, the premise is that you can, that the parents, for example, in a school district will be for it, that you can convince the older people that it costs them nothing to vote for it and that they're somehow propping up their property value. And then you try to keep everybody else kind of in the dark that there's even an election going on. We've even seen in Kentfield something new and kind of disturbing, which we've dubbed voter stalking, where the consultants can purchase real-time data because it's all a mail-in election. Everybody votes early, or just about everybody votes early. And you can figure out who voted and who didn't vote, and if they didn't vote and you think it's one of the people who should be in your camp, you can actually hit them repeatedly with up to six mailers, knocking on your doors repeatedly, and this really happens. Other things that, as far as games that are played, we have pension denial. The consultants figure out what things are most likely to cause you to vote against a tax measure, and highest up on that list are the word pension and disclosing the total dollar of the parcel tax that they will end up paying. So it's always presented as a renewal or as, well, it's just another $100, and you have to read all the way down to the full ballot language to find out how much you have to pay in total. Mm-hmm. And then there is what it called gun to the head, which is that we're told that if you don't vote this time, that let's say $4 million worth of funding translates into 40 teachers at $100,000 per teacher, and they're all going to get their pink slips next week. So now we have TAM Union coming forward with a proposed parcel tax, and I want to give them some positive credit. I think that while no school district and no set of decision makers is perfect, I think that they are making a lot of the right moves, certainly, that that we've been advocating. They, to their credit, and I think this was a big dodged bullet, they tabled a $450 million proposed bond measure and decided to focus instead on their operating deficit, which is really important because you probably only get one bite at the apple, and most voters would think it's most important that that be spent on keeping the teacher count up. They perhaps out of necessity, are also looking at some cost reductions, which is what got us there is unfortunate, but it's good that it's happening, that they're looking at cost reductions. And there is an effort at community outreach and education, and I'd say decent disclosure. So I think at the end of the day, though, it's going to be a tough choice for a lot of voters between what need the school district is able to demonstrate will be fulfilled with the money that is approved or not approved, and whether people can afford it. So that concludes my prepared comments, and I just want to finish with an encouragement for those of you who've found something interesting in what we've had to say today to get involved. We're an all-volunteer organization. We need help. There's more out there than we can possibly deal with. So at the very minimum, give your email address to Paul Primo, who's raising his hand there, to sign up, get on our alert list and be informed. And we could use volunteers, and we could definitely use donations. We're at costwarning.org. Thank you.
Well, first, thank you very much to the Marin Coalition. I really appreciate the opportunity to be here, and thank you, Mimi Willard. I met Mimi about the time that the district, we had a consultant that was helping us look at our facilities, and there was concern that we'd go out for a bond measure, so Mimi invited me for a cup of coffee. And ever since then, she's been really helpful coming to the board and raising very interesting issues. Before we begin, I have to state the disclaimer you probably heard other board members state, which is that as I speak here, I'm not speaking for the board, or technically I'm not speaking as a board member. The board only can operate with five of us, but I am here as a community member who's a board member, so it's a slight difference. In thinking about how to cover what we were talking about today, I thought I would divide it up into five big picture questions. And that way it'll help kind of organize our thoughts. But first I want to talk about who is the district, or what does the district cover? A lot of people don't realize how big the district is. And then go into how does the district serve its students. Started out saying what happens to their taxpayer dollars, but decided to change it to serve, since that's the title of today's talk, is do we cut services or do we raise taxes? And then go into why is the district revenue not keeping pace with its expenses, and how has the district addressed growing expenses thus far? What are we doing now, and what do you plan to do in the future? So first I have to tell you I'm colorblind. I didn't notice till now, but the 76K is black, and the 19 communities on my computer didn't show up. I don't see dark color differences sometimes, so hopefully this is the only slide that's distracting. I don't mean to emphasize those 2 points. But basically, the district has about, over 76,000 registered voters. So we know there's more than that that probably live in the district. That doesn't include anyone under 18, clearly. At geographical boundaries, the district covers just about every city except for San Rafael and Novato. I do understand there's a sliver of households in Centerville that are part of the district, but I'm not really clear where that is. This current year, we have over 4,800 students district-wide, and district students come from 19 communities and 10 feeder schools. The district, when you look at it that way, with the number of communities we serve that come to our high school, we have a huge range of students. We have students that come in with a pretty high level of resources, that come into school, that school is what they love, it comes easy to them, they have strong support at home. And then we have students that are on the other end of the spectrum that really are struggling, that have sometimes a learning issue. Some students have had behavioral issues, maybe the home life isn't stable. A lot of students, you know, have financial issues. We have medical issues. We're a public school, so we serve all the students. So that's the challenge of the district. How do we serve our students now that I've just described big picture, the range of students that we want to serve? It's what the way you would think. We have academics, we have electives, college and career readiness, extra and co-curriculum, and then we also have college counseling and wellness. What I want to point out about the academics is that to meet the needs of this wide range of students, we have multiple pathways for a student to graduate from our high schools. We actually have 5 high schools. We have 3 that are comprehensive, that you would think of as a traditional high school, and then we have 2 that are alternative. And the 2 that are alternative, frankly, I didn't know much about until I was on the board, and I lived in this county for over 30 years, and I think they're really hidden gems. One is Tamaskal, and you'll hear Tamaskal described as independent study, but when you really visit Tamaskal, I actually have a son that went there for 1 year. It's much more like college life, and it just means that you don't go to school from 8 until 3 every day. You have a schedule that's much more like college. You'll have a class that meets maybe once or twice a week, and you're in that class for about an hour and a half, and then you have a lot of work in between. The instructors are available for you in between that time, and it's very rigorous. The beauty of that is that for those students, for example, that either are feeling that they're maybe a little bored, or they don't like sitting in class all day, they can forge ahead and have that experience. Then there's students that sometimes have really diagnosed social anxiety, and it's so rewarding to go to an open house at Tamaskal and have students stand up and say, I couldn't go to school before. I would stay home because I was so anxious, I couldn't learn. And they found a place at Tamaskal, and they're successful and gradually able to work on that. Same thing as we hear of athletes. I understand there was a ballerina that dances. Oops, this is just mine that did that. Ballerina that dances with the San Francisco Ballet, and so with that, she needs to go into the city like at noon. And by having this flexibility, she's able to still excel in her dreams. San Andreas is the other alternative school, and that's more of a continuation school. That's for the students that will not graduate unless they get some extra flexibility and help because they're behind in their credits. And again, the reason why a student lands there can be quite a variety of reasons. Sometimes it's a medical reason. Students that have had to be in the hospital and have been schooled in the hospital. Sometimes it's a student you may have read in the paper that has a head injury because they got hurt playing football and it made them get behind. And then we do have the students that have some behavioral challenges at that campus as well. And that campus was in the paper recently for being, I see a nod, and I'm drawing a blank of what it's called, but it was a state recognition as one of the top state continuation schools. So we're really proud about that. The other thing I want to mention is that what's a little unusual about the district is that all of our core courses, with the exception of one entry-level math course, are accepted as UC and California State University approved curriculum and credits. So whereas many schools in the state have students that only I want to say 50%. I'd have to double check that, but it's surprisingly how many students don't have reached that curriculum when they graduate. In our school, it's very high because they don't have any option but to meet that. And so our students aren't in the position where they have to go out of state or look for a private school. They could go right into the California system. And that was a change that happened gradually over the last few years, and actually it was a bit controversial when the district started to change it, and I was one of the people that kind of wondered, why would you do that? There's so many great courses you're getting rid of. But now I really appreciate that the administrators and teachers moved forward with that. Academic electives is what it states, and I see you have two color tones here, but the academic electives are what it says. So we have a lot of electives that really are more rigorous than when I was in school. In addition to, you know, the arts, which I still think are challenging. I'm saying some of these, like biomedical science, I don't think of as an elective. It's basically biomedical engineering. And then we just started ethnic studies, and of course the drama. AP Capstone, I'll highlight because that's relatively new, and that's an AP course where students actually do research, and they almost come forward and do a presentation like you do when you've got a thesis. That just started this year, I believe. College and career readiness. We have a partnership with College of Marin. College of Marin is working closely with the district as a whole, but in particular right now, they're starting some work at TAM High. We have auto technology. If you've ever been to, I've only been to TAM High auto shop, but it's pretty amazing. And then the one I really like is the Pathways program. I don't know if you've heard of that, but for seniors, and this is amazing to me, that a senior that for whatever reason isn't getting what they need in their high school setting, they can be in the Pathways program. They can choose classes at any of the high schools in the district. They work with College of Marin, get first choice of classes at College of Marin, and they do an internship. So we've had students that have an internship at UCSF, take science courses at College of Marin, and then still take classes in one of the district high schools. I mean, that's pretty incredible that we're able to do that. Then we do have some engineering programs, and you've probably heard of AIM. We have the traditional college counseling and the wellness program, which I can touch upon a little bit more in the following slide. I also want to mention there's the co-curriculum, which is similar to the, I think of it as a little bit of, as an academic extracurricular, but we have the mock trial. That's something that's very closely linked with the English departments, and you probably read that the TAM High mock trial team is now going to the Nationals Model UN. We have a new program that I'm really excited about that is really focused on with students with working on anti-racism. And it's an amazing program that the district has asked teachers to voluntarily. It's open to them. And I went through the program and other board members. But I came home after this program and I said, I don't even know how to describe it. It was not a workshop. It was not a class. It was just this amazing experience. It really opened my eyes, and I think the district's teachers and everyone working with students were a lot more sensitive to what's referred to as microaggressions, and now the students are really excited, and they're a lot better at it than we are with really looking deeply at behaviors that could be seen as racist or biased, and we think that's so important for our students as they go out in the world today. The peer tutoring, I'm going to mention one thing that I thought was noteworthy is that we're hearing, for instance, students that come home. I don't know how many of you have had children in the district, but you get a report card and it's maybe not what you want it to be. They don't want to talk to the parents about it, but they'll talk to a peer that's a year or two ahead of them, and that peer will describe to them what they could do better, give them advice about talking to the teacher, and it's amazing. It's great. We also have traditional, the sports teams, and I don't know the statistic, but a good number, over half of our students are in at least one or two sports, and the sports go year round. So I said I was going to talk about wellness. I think I'll get back to that. But I want to jump into why is the next question number three, which is why is revenue not keeping up with expenses? So it's both sides of the equation. It's not just the revenue, not just the expenses. The revenue growth is slowing. Property taxes, which is our main source of revenue, is growing at a slower rate. And then our expenses, boy, I have a lot of black and blue in here. Oh my goodness, I didn't see it on my home computer. So our expenses are growing it for three reasons, primary reasons. One is the increased enrollment, and that's what I'm talking about most today. Employer contributions to retirement, which Mimi spoke to. And the unfunded or underfunded state mandated programs, and in particular special education. Okay, so now we're going to look just at the revenue side, the sources of funding, and this is a pie diagram, and I think, I don't know, you probably can't read the writing, and I'm not good at the color, so I'm going to point over here. Let me know if you can hear me. So this part of the pie are our property taxes. So it's close to 75%. This is based on this year, but the ratios don't change much from year to year. This is the state revenue, the 6%. Federal is only 1%. And then local revenue is 19%. The next slide will show a close-up of the local revenue. So local revenue, these are the foundations and PTA. Parcel tax is close to $10 million, and it's about 12% of our total revenue. And other local are local grants. And there's other besides local grants, but at the moment I can't think of what it is, but there's other local revenue that we get in about $3 million, $3.8 million. So now I'll touch upon the fact that, like I said earlier, the enrollment growth is hitting us pretty hard. And that together with the rate of property taxes is what's causing the squeeze. And I'm gonna walk over here again. This bar here, the y-axis is the number of students. And the bottom here is 3,000, this goes up to 5,500. And on the x-axis are the years. And this starts at 2006-07, and this is 2021. So we are right here, and that's correct, it's about 4,800. Still expect to rise above 5,000, and in years out, it'll drop a little bit, closer back to the 4,800, but from what we can anticipate now, we know that for the next several years, we're going to be sustaining it up at a high level. And I'm not sure how much of you are aware of this, but because we are a basic aid district, or sometimes referred to as a community-funded district, because we are fortunate enough to have so much income from property taxes, we go beyond what we would normally have even gotten from the state, so we just don't get any more funding from the state when a new student walks in the door. This is basically a pictorial talking. On the left, you'll see the bucket, and it's just showing that in our school district, we get to take the additional funding that we get from property taxes. This is an interesting slide, and I'm gonna walk over the screen again. So the y-axis on this side is our revenue. And you'll remember from the earlier slide, it's primarily property taxes. These are the years down here. And then this is dollar per student. So if you think of when you write a check, if you're a private school, this is kind of the same thing. We look at this as it can go as low as 15,000 per student, as high as 17,000 per student. So just looking at the blue, this is just telling you what our income is. This line incorporates our enrollment. So this is what this is telling you is that our revenue from 2015-16 in particular per student is dropping down to 15,000. The reason why I like this particular slide is that the last 2 years we have not really lowered how much we spend on our students. So this in a way depicts our deficit spending this, the last
last year and a half, 2 years. And that's what we need to correct. So what have we done so far? Now I remember where I was going to talk about wellness. So we've taken multiple initiatives to address the budget enrollment. For one, we included portables for the classrooms. When we were looking at the facilities master plan, one reason why we really needed to take a deeper dive with the demographics was that we didn't want to build facilities for students that might just be a bubble, then you'd have an empty building. That was our first reason for looking into it. Even though it is going to stay at a high level for a while, we needed more housing right away, and we were able to bring in portables at a much, much lower cost. Teachers have doubled up in classrooms, which has also been a savings. We also closed the print shop at Redwood High School. This was a result of a budget study committee that, how much time do I have? Because I'll speed it up. Oh, really? Okay, I'm gonna talk much faster. That's not good when they go like this and you have a few more slides. And then we've done some changes with the master schedule. We realized there were classrooms, we had 5 kids in them. And so there's that. We're not necessarily going to be hiring as many new teachers, but if we get the class size adequate and we have electives that really don't have enough kids, we shouldn't have them. And then also, going back to what Mimi was talking about, I mean, we are a community school. We're a public school. We need to be responsive to the community. We have over 75,000 people in this community. So we started conducting stakeholder interviews in the fall, and we actually did a poll. And where we looked, and the poll, you could look at it in terms of you're going to try and find a way to win, but we didn't look at it that way because the poll asked the community, what do you care about with the district schools? What are you willing to pay more in taxes for a parcel tax? If you are, how much? So it was really getting both sides of the equation in the poll, and we got the poll results back, and we're using them. In addition, we are in the process of developing a cost recovery program for the next 2 years, and we have a team of people that include stakeholders from the community with teachers and students and administrative staff looking at the priorities of the district, taking all that information that we got from the poll as well as different committees of what the community cares and trying to align our priorities in that matter. I'm going to try and speed this up. And then the tax revenue increase, we do not have a resolution in front of us yet. I expect we will at the next board meeting. It is a renewal. It's earlier renewal. It's supposed to expire in 22, but we clearly need it sooner. We're also looking for increasing revenue by, you know, working with our foundations and parents group. And let me see here. I'm not going to go over this. These are some of our LCAP goals. But I can give you this information later. This is one of our guiding principles of how we're going to prioritize how we cut and how we spend. So in summary, the district is not the revenue is not keeping pace with the expenses. We're a community-funded school. District's approach is to do both, cut costs and increase revenue. And we're trying to make adjustments that are in alignment with community values, what's best for our student. And the district is planning for a parcel tax measure in November. You'll notice I don't have a slide that tells you how much, and that's because we haven't passed the resolution, but I can tell you, I just didn't want to put it in writing. What I expect to see come to us, and I assume it's going to be this. We directed the district to come back with a parcel tax renewal that's $149 above the current rate. And if you factor in that when that happens, it'll be in November. And so that means the parcel tax will have already increased. So it would be $293 plus $149 for a total of $442 per year, with a term of 12 years and a 3% escalator. I need water. And I'm going to finish it on a high note. I asked the superintendent, we were at a meeting last night, I was looking for an inspirational quote, and because even though we're faced all this, there's nothing like this district, and there's nothing like public education, and I can only tell you, being on this board, it's amazing what the teachers and the staff do, and the students. It's so inspiring, and I know we'll get through this. There was another quote I have to tell you I saw when I was, because I wanted to look at the source, and there's one about board members that I won't repeat that was by Mark Twain, so if any of you know what I'm referring to, I'll tell you later, but if you have any questions, if you get on our website, I put the website up here, and the easiest thing to do is just look to the left and you'll see TAM District Enrollment Growth Update, and it's a link. If you hit that, there'll also be a place for you to send in questions or comments, and we will be reading all of them. So thank you very much, and I really appreciate the opportunity to be here. Thank you.
Thank you, Leslie. Is this on? Hello?
Yep.
Yes.
You're hearing? Okay, good. Thanks, Steve. Thank you for an excellent and complete presentation as well. Boomies on our way up. We will now entertain your questions. The speakers will stay here in the front. You can either direct your question to one or both of the speakers. Sure. And
I know what your question is.
Sure, why not? I'm going to start with myself. I'm a real estate professional, and I think most realtors will tell you property values are going up every year. At least in the last 7-8 years, and since property taxes are a function of the value of the property, when a house sells, that's the property tax basis. So maybe I'm missing something, but I don't really understand, and I guess this is for Leslie, why there is a decrease in property tax revenue.
I'm using that word, isn't
it? Well, first, I should defer you to the county office, to the tax assessor, but I went to a presentation that he provided a few weeks ago and noted that it's about 4.5%, for instance, this year, and next year, 4.75, it might be reversed. And he talked about the fact that it has a lot to do with the number of houses that are selling into how old the house has been. I'm not talking very well. You know how you pay the same property tax for years and years, and until you sell, it doesn't get reassessed. It sounds like, listening to him, that was one of the major factors, but there were a number of variables that he showed during the workshop, and I think he's probably best to answer that question.
Okay, other questions? Yeah. And by the way, here's the deal on the mic. Like, right next to your mouth, okay? Because otherwise no one will hear you. If you do this, no one will hear you. Thank you.
Hello, I'm a San Anselmo resident. I've been a Redwood parent for 10 years, and I've been following endless meetings at the board with Leslie on my side many times when we were concerned about what was going on at the district. And I made a minor, minuscule contribution to get Leslie elected because I thought that she would be a very good person to represent the interests of the parents and the taxpayers at the board. And I kind of gave up because it's impossible to get real information from the district. I had to do multiple FOIA requests to get very basic information about what's going on, and they spend thousands of our dollars in attorneys to stop us to know what's going on, including what I call the black hole of surveys. It's impossible to get the result of a single survey from the district, and I would like Leslie to formally commit now that you will release the survey that you mentioned about what the residents really want about the new possible tax, because nobody has seen the result. You tell us what you think are the results, but we never see the real data. And I hope that you also fire the PR firm that wanted to neutralize the opposition being me, a taxpayer, or is still there. Because any other organization would have fired on the spot a company paid by taxpayers' money to neutralize the taxpayers. And you know what I'm referring to. And 8 years ago, the reserves of the district were almost $24 million, $24 million. And many parents went there were concerned that they were going down and down and down. Now I think it's about 3 million.
What's the question?
And no, that's the question. I have a question. And at the same time, the expenses went up. So what's going on? Why nobody stopped the expenses if you knew about the wave of new students? You kept spending like crazy. And why there is never a double, classroom for the administrators? It's always the teachers who got to double up. Why you don't cut administrators?
Let her answer. Thank you.
I'm hoping I catch everything. First, the survey I'm referring to, the polling survey, it was presented at a board meeting and it had all the results, and so I think I have your email address. I'll make sure I send that to you.
Would that be in the minutes?
It would be, and if you get on, and I just have to remember what day. I'll tell you if it comes to me. But yeah, if you get on Agenda Online and double click on that date, you'll find the presentation. But one point you made that I agree with, we do have to do better with our community information. Even when you get on the website, you'll find parts of it challenging. It's something we're looking at. Sometimes you don't know it until something happens that everybody wants the information, and that happened about a month ago when there was information that people thought we were doing drastic cuts the next day. And when that happened, it was clear that we need to look at our website and other ways of communicating. You also talked about neutralize. I know what you're referring to. I do remember that meeting, and I know there were a lot of people concerned about using that term. The district chose not to fire that firm based on that comment when the consultant explained that it's not the way it was intended. And as a district, we're really responsible for any actions or work that's done. It's not that's our job. I'm so sorry, Benedetto, you said so many interesting things and I'm
cutting expenses, we are
cutting expenses, and that's what I was trying to explain, and I was at the point where I was talking awfully fast, is that we're lucky that we had, our reserve now is actually closer to $16 million this year. Before that, you're right, it was closer to 25 or 30, and the beauty of a reserve is that it's there if there is a emergency, a big emergency, but it also, that's what it's for. It's so that when you know you have to make a correction, you don't turn around and fire 10% of your staff. That you can do it thoughtfully and do it along the lines of what your goals are for your school. And that's where we are now. And we're using the reserve as a cushion while we figure out where we're going to cut, how much, and when. And it also afforded us time to do more of a thorough evaluation of what parcel tax value the community was able and willing to bring forward. I am surprised you didn't bring up one thing. I'll bring it up because someone else probably will. When you say that why do we keep spending? There was a controversial vote that I actually voted against, and I changed my mind, and I'm glad I changed my mind. There was wellness centers that came forward, and wellness centers came forward and sounded awfully expensive when we knew there was this looming issue around the corner. Since I didn't change my mind, and then since that time, I am very, I'm very convinced. I'm now talking as a community member who happens to be a board member, but I'm convinced from visiting the schools and talking to the students how much the wellness centers linked with our counseling centers really are helping our students and how widely used they are. There's ways to, a lot of the services are free to the district, and wellness centers along with everything else of value though is on the table now to look at how we can do it more efficiently. When you think about the target value of $3 million to cut this next year, that's actually on a percentage basis a pretty small amount. I think any organization can find ways to economize, and that's where we are now. Is there anything else, Benedetto?
Why don't we move on to other
questions?
Yeah,
sorry about that.
I want to thank both of you for informative and thoughtful presentations. You mentioned pensions as being a big part of, a growing part of the financial burden, I guess, or difficulty. At the last meeting, or one we had sometime in the past about that, I was asking somebody, is there anything we can do about it? And somebody mentioned that there's some place in the United States which has put a cap on total pension payments so that people can't play with in the final years before they retire by jacking up consulting or overtime or whatever else. Is there any, is there anything, Mimi, I guess this is maybe a question more towards you, is there anything here in Marin County that's sort of looking at that?
Sorry. And actually, before I answer that question, I do have the question in mind. I just want to mention a couple things that I forgot to say in my prepared comments. Number one, Doug Kelly, who's here, he has information about a public forum that we're hosting on May 3rd for the district attorney campaign. We'll be having a debate at San Rafael City Hall, and thank you, Kate Collin, for being our conduit to access to a free forum. And also, we will have our PowerPoint up on our website. Some people asked about that, and probably a link to the video of this. But in answer to your question about pension, I'm actually going to punt because we are very fortunate to have on our among our board of directors people who have more expertise in this, like Paul Primo. So I'm going to let you answer, Paul.
Oh.
Paul also serves on the Citizens for Sustainable Pension Plans and is a financial whiz kid.
Well, I'll try. Governor Brown passed a reform bill package that became effective the 1st of 2013 for new employees only. But in that also was provisions to restrict spiking for existing employees. The Marin Union filed suit against the administrator of the pensions, saying that they should not be applicable to previous employees. They lost the Superior Court, they lost at the Appellate Court, and the Supreme Court has taken it up. So stay tuned. And that is a spiking issue. There's a couple other cases that the Supreme Court will be looking at also. So there's hope out there.
That's California Supreme Court.
I'm sorry, California Supreme Court.
Thank you. And Leslie, if you want to tag team, you got people here too. So.
Mimi, I'm Rick Barham, and I found your slide on local contributions the most interesting for me, in that roughly 19 million or 19%, was it 19 million is being contributed, and 10 million of that is from parcel taxes for the schools. And as I understood it, 1% was from the state.
No, 1% from the feds.
1% from the feds. And it's low because we apparently are a very generous bunch, and we tax ourselves on parcel taxes to the amount, as I remember, of 10% or $10 million. Is that right? So I guess my question is this. What would that look like if we reversed that? If we just weren't a generous bunch and we didn't have partial taxes anymore, what would happen with the Fed contribution and what would happen at the state level?
We would have much less than we have now.
I don't what would that number be?
I don't have the exact number, but it'd be much lower, much lower. We're really lucky we have a good school district because we are able to offset it with the parcel tax and the property tax. It'd be significantly lower. And if the one thing I do want to say, anyone that has a question that I'm not able to answer, like this gentleman, I'm not giving you the exact number. I would like very much to get your email, and then we will get you that information afterwards.
Now, Rick, I don't have the direct answer to your question
either, but one thing that I do know is if you look at a map of California,
right,
parcel taxes are only in a few places, in strong clusters. And it's basically the Bay Area, certain parts of the LA area, and the rest of the state doesn't have them. And so basically what's happening is that the places that have the higher per capita incomes are willing to top up whatever they would get from the state, which is largely tied to your Prop 13 contributions and so on. So this is a high class problem in a certain sense, but it is a problem because we've all gotten accustomed to what comes with having that extra money, and we may be reaching the end of the road as far as people's willingness to contribute more to it.
Hi, I'm Jody Morales, and this is for both of you nice ladies that came to educate us today. My question concerns the arguments on the ballot measures. Most people who get a parcel tax on their mail-in ballot, which I also disagree with, only see that one. But those of us who are far more inquisitive get them from other districts too that are promoting a parcel tax. And what we have found is that the language on the two arguments are almost identical. They cover exactly the same talking points as if it came from central casting, and it's just pretty insulting, I think, to the voter for that to happen. The other thing that is missing, as Mimi pointed out, is any reference at all to the pension debt that is driving this need for more money, because the money is being used elsewhere. My question for, is this. Why don't the schools jump on board with pension reform as far as advocating, maybe join in with the arguments, the amicus briefs at the state level now to see if something can be done to get them under control and allow the money that is generated for the schools to actually go for the schools and for the teachers. I have great admiration for the teachers and for the education system in Marin County. I'd like it to see that way, but stay that way. I don't want the taxpayers to be taxed out of the county. Thank you.
So, comment on your first part of your question. We will not see the actual language until the April 17th board meeting, and I appreciate you pointing that out. It'll help me and anyone else that hears this have a little more critical eye when we look at that language. In terms of why doesn't the school board get involved, you know, legislatively at the state level, that actually is something that has been discussed at our board meeting. And one of the board members here is a representative of JLAC. She's in the back of the room. And the reason why she's not talking is the attorney for the district suggested that the other board members not talk because of the Brown Act. But I'm sure that she will, we're gonna talk to you. She's there, back there. And so our board just recently, we're getting more involved with that. We did a resolution on gun control last week, and we did one on fair funding, passed a resolution. So our board is talking about getting much more in front of things.
I'd like to
add just a little bit to that, if I can find it here. So Jody actually showed me before the meeting two side-by-side recent ballot measures, one for Kentfield Measure A and the current one for Dixie District Measure B, and I mean, they're like photocopier. There is kind of a script here of what gets put on them. It's, you know, it's standard legal language, but it's also what plays well according to the polls. So you hear statements like, these funds will only be used for, and it will be so and so, you know, it will be add extra teachers to the classroom, produce smaller class sizes, etc. Not a penny for pensions, none for administration, which is kind of a half-truth because, as we talked about before, the general fund is paying for all that, which is why we need the parcel tax. The other point that I didn't talk about before, well, of course, we always hear about renewal and we don't hear about how much the tax is going up. But the other part of the gaining is this inflation increases. These aren't inflation increases. They're typically on the ballot. It will say, you know, it will start at $1,100 with annual inflation increases. But they're not tied to any measure of inflation. They're a fixed number. And the number that's been prevailing has been 3%, but some of the districts are pushing it to 5%, and out in Lagunitas it went to 6.5%, which is the reason why we oppose that tax measure. Nobody's income that I know is going up 6.5%. The other thing that's happening with the high pension payments to the what's called the classic employees, the ones who were hired before PEPFRA, which Paul talked about, is that they're starting to like crowd out the younger teachers' ability to get the income that they want. And there was a really, I thought, articulate, pithy little contribution to the letters to the editor of the IJ about a month ago from Ken Broad, who talked about this as cannibalization. I think that at a certain point the numbers are going to progress in such a way that the school districts are going to have to start to advocate, but right now they really don't want to because they feel like they're at cross purposes, I think, maybe with some of their employee base. So can't speak for Leslie.
Okay. Doug Kelly, Leslie, first off, thanks so much. I thought you did a great presentation. Invention is a mother necessity, as they say. I face the same criticism on the Ross Valley Sanitary Board of Directors that we have a lot of sanitary districts in Marin. And one of the things we're doing, we were originally called Sanitary District Number 1, so don't blame me that there was a number 2. But at any rate, there are a lot of them. And the way to solve that in the short term is through shared services. Is there some shared services your district could do with San Rafael and Novato and the other districts in Marin so that you can cut the costs and increase services at the same time?
I'm really glad you asked that question because there was something I wanted to speak to during the presentation. You heard us talk about these unfunded state mandatory programs and special education being one of them. It's doubled in cost in the last 4 years and it's now at $10 million per year. We did a lot of work with that. I shouldn't say we, I didn't, but the special education department in the district and looked at the costs that the district was spending on transportation for some of the special ed students that need to be sent to a different outside school facility, including students that actually need to be in a boarding type situation. And looked at it very closely and determined that we could do actually a better job. And so a new portable was placed at Tamaskal. And now we have very happy parents that don't have to send their children to overnight school. It's getting such good results and good reviews that we have in a school district on the East Bay that has asked to send one of their students to our school for, you know, it's a fair amount of money. And so it saved us money also before that even occurred. We knew it was going to save us about $500,000 a year once the startup costs were spent, and the startup costs really were the physical, putting in the utilities and the portable. So that was already a savings, and then now it's becoming revenue generating. It's making students happier, they're better off, and their families are happier. So that story I'm very pleased with. Did that answer your question?
Yeah, and I hope you continue to work on other shared services.
Yes,
you know.
And I agree. And in fact, I saw Catherine, and I mean, not just with other schools, but our cities. And there's so many opportunities.
Can I give you one quick
yes,
example?
Yes,
in,
please.
In the fire departments of Marin, some are consolidating. Mm-hmm. Some are not consolidating exactly, but shared services such as sharing captains, battalion captains.
Right.
So do we need... We talked about how many administrators we have. Couldn't somebody be a part-time mm-hmm. assistant principal here and a part-time mm-hmm. assistant principal there? I'm just making some...
No, know. I think that those are really good points, and that's actually, even within the district, because we do have five high schools, that's part of what's on the table with this other study group of looking at how we can share services across the schools. Not every school has a duplicate number of resources or... offerings, and so students are free if they find they are better situated at one of the different high schools. We do allow for transfers, but I think you raise a really good point. I'm sure there's some creative solutions here, especially in this community.
Running low on time, but if our speakers are okay with a few more minutes, is that all right? Okay, we'll take a few more questions.
Well,
one
more question.
You
talk about you
cannot
hear. When you speak of the future income, there is going to be a decline in the population that are contributing to the income, because seniors are the increasing portion of your community, and especially in places like Mill Valley or the more settled communities. And so you will have a decreased income. And then the young people are drawn to Camelopardos Union High School District, because when I became a teacher, there were supposed to be three districts in the whole state that were top districts. Well, now apparently Camelopardos High School is one of the top schools, and if you apply internationally, you were given a space, though I know in my own family, that going to St. Andrews, which is, you had your choice of going to five different schools in England, because the town district, and especially Camelopardos Union High School, which has a diversity of students, the challenge, I think, for Tam High School is that they need to work with the incoming student schools, especially the Bolinas young people and the people from the Sausalito School District. Thank you.
Okay, so for those who might not have heard, I think the question is, how do you maintain the quality of schools when you have an aging population and yet high demand for the school? Although, on the other hand, if you have a aging population, you have probably fewer school-aged children, but I'll let you guys address that.
I had intended to bring today a slide on the demographics, which I didn't bring. But basically what's happening in Marin, I got some very good data from ABAG, and I can put that up with a PowerPoint presentation. And what it shows is that our over 60 group is steadily expanding as a percent of the total population in Marin over the last, I'm going to make it up, I want to say 10 years of data that I have. Much of the offset is in the young adult group. I mean, people who are right out of college don't have jobs or can't afford to live here. But the other thing that's kind of interesting to me that I think tells us something about the future and how unaffordable it is here, we're seeing declines now in the people of the young family formation age group. And we saw that, for example, in Kentfield, there they actually have declining enrollment now in K to 2. So some of that's the price of buying the house, but some of it also is the cost of the taxes once you're in the house, because it could be tens of thousands of dollars annually that you're paying towards that. So this is going to lead into leads into a question about, like, how long should our parcel taxes be in existence for anything? But let's talk about schools. I mean, if you have a very long parcel tax, you're talking about a parcel tax there to educate some number of students who haven't been born yet. So we don't like taxes that go forever, and we generally don't like taxes that are out of line with what's a visible, reasonable term.
I don't know if you have anything to say about demographics.
Just to add that apparently in the 2014 election, it was close to 50% of the voters were over, 65 years or older. And for the district, since we don't get more funding based on students, if our student population drops, it actually would bring us back to where we were about 8 years ago. And I do want to mention that one thing that all schools do is they always are looking at their enrollment growth. Some schools want it because they do get more funding. And there's standard ways of doing that, looking at 3-year survival rates in the school, how many students tend to progress. They look at the feeder schools. But because we knew that we had not only facilities, we took it a step further and did a much more in-depth demographic study where went all the way down to the kindergarten level. And so we have data that shows a projection, a good 10 years out from when we started, which was 2016. And it shows all the schools. And it was much more of a rigorous approach. And that was so that we could really do better planning, so we knew how critical it was. I think I'm getting so I sometimes forget what some of the questions were. But did you teach in the district?
Yes, I did.
And what's your name?
It's Pittman Ziegler, but I retired in 1981.
Oh, congratulations. How many people here are graduates of TAM District? Oh, that's great. I love that.
Okay, question over here.
In fact, my question was asked by, the question I had was asked by you, and thank you for that. I think his question is far more significant than was given recognition to. It's not only a matter of sharing best practices, but reducing costs thereby. I would like to make a couple observations, however. I hope that the Kentfield tactics used for their school tax doesn't interfere with your TAM district tax. I think what they did in Kentfield was disgraceful. I would like to thank and express my appreciation for the existence of COST and CSPP. I don't know what position we would be in if we didn't have them as our spokespeople. So thank you immensely.
Okay, Basha.
Last month, the Kentfield School Tax Measure A passed by 89 votes. And the question's for you, Mimi. Do you think there should have been a recount? One, and two, if your tax group, COST, had opposed this from the very beginning, do you think that would have made a difference?
Thank you, Basha, board member of Marin United Taxpayers Association Alliance. So those are a couple of interesting questions. The 89 number isn't exactly the right number. I think that is based on if 89 people had voted yes who voted no. So it has a multiplier effect because it takes two-thirds to pass. But be that as it may, We did look at those numbers carefully, and we just did not feel that relative to the total number of votes passed, that it merited the expense of paying for a recount. We had a lot of back and forth on the Kent Fields School District Measure A, and as you are aware, we initially took a stance of no position, and the reason that we did that was that we felt that our text grading criteria has a list of things that we take into consideration. And on our first look at it, basically what happened was that, number one, there were some people within the group, and we have kind of a democracy within our group, who felt strongly that that they did not want to disrupt the revenue stream to the school district. And we had a range of opinions that ranged from that on through to people at the other end who felt that, for example, the pensions needed to be properly disclosed and had not been. So we ranged from people who were strong yes to people who were strong no, and within our group that just came out as no position. As circumstances evolved, one of the things that happened was that it became clear that some of the tactics being used by the district were really dividing the community, and we felt it was a very unfortunate situation. We also began to learn more about alternative tax approaches, and wanted to encourage the district to look at those as an alternative given the amount of division that was going on within the community. We felt that there was time for them to have another try at a parcel tax before the current one expired. So, coulda, woulda, shoulda, would things have gone differently? Had we done something different? It's just impossible to know now. I mean, I would say they ran an extraordinarily well-funded, very aggressive, very well-organized pro-campaign, and they worked for every vote that they got. And on a going forward basis, I think one of the lessons to a taxpayer group is how are you going to meet that challenge? We are 501c4, and the reason that we're c4 is because we want to do advocacy. We also want to be able to, if we have money, to spend it on advertising, should it become necessary. That's something that contributions from people like you might help towards in the future. We're also thinking, by the way, of adding a side-by-side 501c3, because most of what we do right now is tax-deductible type of stuff, like research and education. Yes, that could be deducted.
One more question, please. Just what will be very
important. Anyway.
How else are you funded besides donations?
Cost, you mean?
Yes,
the Coalition of Sensible Taxpayers operates on a shoestring. I think last year, Paul's our treasurer, I think he had $6,000 last year to work with. That came from public meetings that we sponsor where we ask people to make a contribution if they can, but our suggested amount is small. It's $15, $10, something like that. It basically just covers our expense of having that forum. There are a handful of people who have stepped up with $1,000 or more contributions, but not enough. And I don't know if we will, if we'll be able to ever go up against a really big, well-funded opponent unless people are willing to step up and give us more money than we have now.
Right. I can't resist one last question. It's probably for Mimi, but either one. And then I'm going to have to cut it off for time reasons. But I'm sitting here.
We'll be around.
Pardon?
We'll be around.
Great. Okay. Yeah. Terrific. I'm sitting here listening to the discussion about property taxes as a basis for funding the schools. Well, we just had the federal government passed the Bash California Tax Renewal Plan of 2018, which caps our state and local taxes, which includes property taxes, at $10,000. Anybody who bought a house in 2018 for $1 million is above that $10,000 limit from the get-go. So what impact, if any, do you see in the lesser deductibility of state and local, including property taxes, going forward under the new tax law?
That was one of the issues that was raised at the meeting at the county office, is with the tax collector agent. Was that very? That was one of the uncertainties and variables of why the future is uncertain with what's going to happen with the property tax revenue.
Mimi, anything?
I would think that the fact that SALT deductions, state and local taxes, are capped at $10,000, would, and also that mortgage interest deduction is capped to some extent at the higher end, and we certainly have higher end houses here in Marin, I would think that would at some point have an effect on people's willingness to pay for more taxes and frankly to pay the higher property values, but we shall see how that plays out. So far we've only had one test case in the new year so far, which is Kentfield School District, and I can't tell whether it made any difference or not, but we shall see how that plays out after people have paid their taxes in the first year under the new regime. As I said before, I think that this is going to fall heavily on the condo owners, and it will be interesting to see how that particular dynamic plays out. Yes, Liz.
So I have one general comment. I heard a lot of discussion about the way the measures are worded, that there's a sense that somehow school districts are trying to trick the voters. And for me, when I look at the outreach, the feedback we get from parents, the goals of the district, and then when we do a poll to find out what the voters really value, and we use that to decide where we're going to make cuts and how we're going to use new revenue and how we're going to do it, to be honest, that's how I look at it. I don't look at it as though I'm trying to trick anybody. When I hear from the poll that people really care about science in the core curriculum, that's in alignment with what our goals are. And so I'm very curious, because I've heard discussion here about the pension. I want to go back and see when I get that in front of me, look at it. But if the poll showed, the survey we'll call it, the poll showed that nobody cared about, I'll just pick something, clay ceramics. Why would we decide to make clay ceramics a priority and put it in our ballot as something that we're going to make a priority? It sounds very simplistic, but I really hope that you look at both sides of that, that it's not all trying to trick and get something out to the voters so they'll vote yes. You're trying to hear what the voters want so you can give the voters what they want, because you're who we represent and this is your school. So it's not, I just urge you to consider that as well when you look at these.
And I'll make one other brief comment, which is that it's beholden upon all of you to read the entire ballot statement, because it's the summary ballot statement where things kind of get glossed over, that's where you see things like increase with inflation without describing what it is. You have to read all the way down to the bottom to get the full ballot measure, the language of it, read it, and also read council's evaluation of it, because often there's some important disclosures in there and some good even-handed perspective. So if you just read the three sentences of the summary ballot measure, you're really doing yourself a disservice as an engaged voter.
Let's thank both our speakers for an excellent presentation. Thank all of you for staying and for your excellent questions. I thought it was a terrific session. And we hope to see many of you in May for the Buck Institute. Thank you.